support for Revelation Foundation. Thank you for making it possible.
Questions and you want answers. Welcome to the Q&A show.
Yes, indeed. Welcome to the Q&A show. We are live. It's Thursday evening and I'm delighted to have your company tonight. We're talking about something that as Christians we don't like to admit is going on amongst us as Christians. And yet we're talking about something that's going to have an impact upon so many homes. Let me just give you a little taster of some of the statistics concerning what we're talking about tonight. 75% of all the population in the United Kingdom have been involved in this activity in the last 12 months. And out of those people, 500,000, half a million of those people have got a serious problem with it. What are we talking about? We're talking about the subject of gambling and we're talking about addiction. And I'm delighted to say that with me in the studio, and we're live here, with me in the studio is a gentleman, Justin Rees-Larkham. Justin, great to have you. Thank you so much for coming.
Michael.
And you're going to share your story a little later on, I hope, and just tell us about some of the journey that you've been on. If I said to you, define gambling for me, what would you say?
Well, gambling really is a risk for a reward. And it's placing something at stake to get something back. And I guess in the UK that covers a wide range of things, from playing poker right the way through to a lottery scratch card. Even a raffle ticket is potentially gambling.
But some people will say, but an occasional flutter on the national lottery or the Grand National, you know, what's the harm in that? How do you move on from gambling to gambling being a problem?
I think the issue is that, unfortunately, there's a proportion of all those people, you mentioned that statistic, that proportion of people, because it's such a large number of people that are gambling, some of those people go on to have a pathological problem with it. And in March 2013, it was recognised as a formal addiction rather than just a compulsive behaviour.
Okay. Well, we're looking forward to talking with you tonight and just talking about it. I mean, when we talk about gambling and addiction, there are so many different ways that you can watch today. I mean, in the era that I grew up, it used to be the pools on a Saturday afternoon and a piece of paper was collected and sent off. But these days, gambling can take so many different ways, can't it?
Absolutely. And if you were to go to your laptop now and log in, you'd find 2,500 gambling websites that you can access. The danger is that gambling has become incredibly accessible. And for our children, the younger ones, and it's the 16 to 14-year-old age group that are having the most problems, they're the ones calling the gambling helplines. They're the ones that are the most adept at smartphone technology.
Okay. You at home may think, well, I don't have a problem on gambling, but one of the interesting statistics that I saw was a statistic which said that for every person with a serious problem, and we're saying there's 500,000 in this country at this moment of time, there are 15 people who are affected. Now, I haven't done my sums on that, but that works out at about 7.5 million people who are affected. So it may well be that there's somebody within your family, there's somebody within your circle of friends who's got a problem, and it may be that you need to ring them up and tell them they need to hear tonight the story that we're going to be sharing, or if they can't watch the program tonight, maybe they need to watch the repeat of it. Similarly, if you've got some questions on gambling and addiction and you'd like some help, we'd love to hear from you. Live at revelationtv.com is the address, or text us on 077 8147 2847. So the definition which I found on the web today was it was behaviour which causes disruption in any major area of life.
Yeah.
That sounds quite a sort of serious one. But if we look at your story for a moment, Justin, you were never involved in gambling for the first 40 years of your life. In fact, I read your story and I got halfway through it and I thought, this guy is, you know, everything's going well for him. What's the issues? And the early part of your life, you had such a good life, if I can put it in that way, in the nicest way. Everything you did, you seemed to be successful at. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the highs of your life?
Sure. I had a career in the army to start with. I spent 8.5 years in the army. When I joined the army, I was awarded the Queen's Sword of Honour for coming top of my intake at the Royal Military Academy Sandhurst. I went on to be one of the youngest majors in the British Army for a couple of years. I served in Bosnia, served in Northern Ireland. And I had a great career in the army. And I left and then I went to the city. And I was earning, by the time I was 40, a six-figure salary. I was married to the girl of my dreams. We had a young boy. And we had pretty much everything we could want. We had lovely holidays. We drove nice cars. And I guess, if you'd looked from the outside, people maybe would have thought, well, they've kind of made it. But on the inside, no, there were serious cracks appearing.
But the highs in your life, the success in your life, didn't cause you in the first 40 years of your life to get involved in gambling. I mean, did you occasionally have a flutter? Did you occasionally
gamble? I didn't know how to do it. I wouldn't have understood. I was always quite careful with my money. If someone at work organised a sweepstake, I would have put my pound in like everyone else did, but I would never have organised it. I wouldn't have understood how it worked. On the Grand National, if someone said, I'm going to place a bet on this, can someone give me £5? I would have given them £5 and you know, said, you can have that one because I like the colours. I really wouldn't have understood how. And it wasn't until I was sitting at home one day and I saw this rugby match on TV. There was an advertising hoarding by the side of the pitch saying £5 free bet. I don't know whether I was bored. Our son Matthew had just had a diagnosis for right side hemiplegia. He'd had a huge fit. He nearly died in my arms. Actually, we were giving him mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. And 2 weeks later, I was at home, maybe a bit bored. And I kind of went upstairs, got my laptop, and in 2 minutes, I opened an account. It was that easy.
Mm-hmm. And you'd never done it before?
Never done it before.
And did you get a kind of thrill out of doing that, or did it just sort of happen and go and pass you by?
Do you know, that is a really good question, because I won that bet. And I truly believe if I'd lost, I would have just closed the laptop down, so that's a waste of time. But I won, and if I hadn't won, I don't know what would have happened. I didn't tell my wife. That was significant. When she came home, I didn't tell her that I'd won this bet. I just thought it was a bit of harmless fun. And over the next few months, that's the way I saw it. You know, I'd bet occasionally a few pounds on a sports game. I loved sport. I was passionate about it. I kind of kidded myself that I knew something about it. Well, clearly I didn't, because I realised suddenly after maybe about 6 months that I was losing more than I was winning. And I calculated what I'd lost. And I could see that I was down about £650, £700. And I'm immensely competitive. I hate losing. And I'm an optimist. And those are not good traits to have if you're betting. So I did the classic thing, which you should never do, which is chase my losses. And I calculated that to win everything back in one go and have my account back into credit, I had to put a bet of £1,000 down on a tennis match that was playing at that time. I think I even went into an overdraft to get that money. And I lost that bet. And when I did that, I'd stepped over the line.
Okay. But, I mean, we need to give your story away by saying that ultimately everything fell apart for you. But it's a huge step from what you've just described, which was, you know, a bit of fun, going to a website, putting a bet on, enjoying your rugby and thinking, oh, you know, will I win or lose, to where you got to. So can you begin to talk about the journey and how it is that someone like you, who is as clever as you are, you've been at Sandhurst, you were the top soldier of your year, you got the Sword of Honour, all those things, you went into business, you equally were successful and became managing director within a period of time. How did you go on that slippery slope?
Do you know, that is exactly the word I'd describe. It is a slippery slope, and you don't even realise it's happening. Can I just talk about what a compulsive gambler is, so that there's a distinction, I think. We talk about 75% of all adults gambling. Of that, maybe 98, 99% don't have a problem. there is a 1 or 2% of the population, 500,000 people, say, let's take that figure, and I think it's even an industry figure. The compulsive gambler will walk into a betting shop. He'll put £50 on a bet, and if he loses, he'll think, oh, no, I've got to bet some more because I can't walk away from here. I've got to win. He's expecting to win. He's really surprised when he or she doesn't win, so they'll keep betting. When they win, they'll think, well, this is great. I'm on a winning streak here, and they'll just keep betting and betting. But a normal person, anyone who most people out there who maybe don't have the genetic makeup or who don't have the external circumstances that have created, for me, this perfect storm, they'll walk in. If they win, they'll think, great, I can take that money away, I can go and treat my girlfriend, take her out for a meal, whatever it might be. And if they lose, they'll think, that hurt, and they'll walk away. And that is the difference between someone who is going to develop a problem with gambling and someone who won't.
But I suppose the question is, how do you know if that is going to be an issue? Because back to saying, 40 years of your life, you led, if I can call it a normal life, you led a very successful life. You had the Porsches, you had the house, you had the car, the nice holidays. So it's almost like you got to 40, which is often described as a midlife crisis for men, and something changed.
And the picture we're seeing at the moment is a picture of me enjoying that good life. But if you look closely at this picture, just behind me is Mount Vesuvius. And we all knew what happened to Mount Vesuvius. You see, inside me, inside my head, there is a person who has certain character traits. Some people talk about it being an addictive personality. I just think it's being full on. I kind of have to do all or nothing. That's why, you know, I'm driven when I'm in the army. I'm driven when I'm working in the city. I want to be the best. And that smug smile on my face was about to come off. I can tell you that right now. Because inside me is a person that doesn't like to lose, that's fiercely competitive, and that is an optimist. And actually, if you recognise, and some people say that addiction comes through a line of the family, and if you've got a father who has, you know, maybe a drinking problem or whatever, just be careful. I'm not saying that you would become an addict, and I think it's wrong to say that. But there is a gene, I do believe, that means you are more susceptible to a repetitive behaviour that leads to an addiction. And for me, what gambling did is it gave me an escape from a reality. I was in denial about my son Matthew. When I understood that he was, and here he is now, you know, when I was told that he was going to be disabled for the rest of his life, limited movement down his right side, constantly fitting in and out of hospital, never drive a car, I went into complete denial. My wife handled it brilliantly. So inside me were these characteristics, the full-on personality, and then coupled with that, a bit of a plateau at work, maybe I'd reached 40 and I thought, you know, what next? A denial about my son, who I loved to bits. These were all things, maybe, that contribute. And in my story, when I've written my story, I leave the reader to make those conclusions themselves. But I would just say, if you are aware of someone in your family that has an addiction, and if you feel you are that kind of character that's a full-on character, just be careful. Because it's not just gambling you have to be careful about. Maybe it's the other things as well. I'm thinking wider. I'm thinking compulsive eating, issues around eating, drink, and drugs. Those are things that someone who has a full-on personality, maybe when they're exposed to them at the right time, it may go on from being just a little habit into something that's a full-blown addiction.
Well, you at home, we'd love to hear from you. Maybe you've got some questions about gambling and why it is that people can become addicted to it. Or maybe you've got issues on other forms of addiction that particularly men can get involved with, but also women as well. We'd love to hear from you live at revelationtv.com. Maybe you've got a story to tell tonight. Well, if so, please do email or text us in as well. And as the evening goes on, we'll be able to share as much of them as we can do. And already, Chris, you've written, you've said, I used to gamble, and it always makes you drink too, and always makes you broke, and having no car, and always makes you letting people down. The only way out for me was a fall on my knees and crying help to God. And I gave up drinking, smoking, and betting all in one day. God bless, says Chris. Well, thanks, Chris, for that. But maybe some of you are secret. And I think as we listen to the story of Justin in a few moments, then we're going to hear the secretiveness that often gamblers have. Maybe you've never shared it with anyone. If you want to write in tonight anonymously and just ask some questions or seek help, then please do. And listen towards the end, and we're going to be talking about some of the steps that can be taken in order to help people who've got this kind of addiction. So, Justin, let me go back. One of the things people may recognize in your name, a Christian heritage that you have. I'm old enough to remember one of your grandparents being Tom Rees, a man who could fill the Royal Albert Hall, I think, 50 times in his life. And his great thing was being able to recite almost the whole of the New Testament. So many stories about him. So you've got that heritage, and your mum equally, who I interviewed for A Heroes of a Faith story, a remarkable story. So did that affect you as a child? Did you grow up believing and having faith? Where does your story fit in there?
Yeah, I feel incredibly privileged to come from this Christian heritage. But I had to come to the point of faith myself. I had six brothers and sisters, and we always used to vie for attention. But I came to the point of faith myself, actually at a young age. And I always had a very close walk with God. And at Sandhurst, and I think maybe one of the reasons why I got the Sword of Honour is I made a stand at Sandhurst that I wouldn't play rugby on Sunday. And the rugby trial, or the second rugby trial, was on a Sunday. And I said the absolute thing you never say at Sandhurst, which was, no, I don't want to play rugby on Sunday. They respected that. I didn't get selected. I was on the reserves bench. But the person in my position got injured after 2 minutes. I was on. I played the best game I'd ever played in my life. And I was captain of the rugby team within about 2 weeks. And he who honours me, God will honour, will I will also honour. And that's absolutely a verse that I've carried through right the way. But when I had that first bet, I'd lost sight of God. I was puffed up full of my own pride. And I just thought, you know, I've made it in life. I'm doing okay. I made all the excuses. Oh, there's not a good church nearby, or I have to leave too early for work and I can't have a quiet time. And I kind of let God take it. I never lost my faith. I never stopped believing. But I pushed him away. And I think when you have a habit that you know is wrong, whatever that habit is, it acts to push God away. It acts like a big cloud, a barrier between you and him, and your walk with him. And that's what happened to me.
Mm-hmm. And in your childhood, you moved house quite a lot of times. You were involved in experiencing death, which maybe children aren't in a very real way. Do you think those kind of things affected you, or are they excuses?
Do you know what? If you'd asked me that 4 years ago, I'd have laughed. And I'd have just said, no way. I am who I am, and that's it. Actually, what I've come to realize over the last few years, as I've got to know myself better, is that the things that happen to us in childhood do affect us in later life. They fundamentally do, particularly the relationships we have around our parents. And at age 13, I can remember the conversation I had with my dad. He came in to tell me that he'd just said goodbye to mum, and she wasn't going to make it through the night. She'd either respond to the drugs or she won't. And I cried right the way through that night, but she made it. My relationship, the stability that she gave me after that, I was lost, I think. I was always ready to let her go. I became much more independent. Mm. And I think maybe that also is a danger. If you are an independent person and you don't rely on other people to keep you on the straight and narrow, if you're not accountable to anyone, it's quite dangerous.
Right. Justin, your life was on a high. And I think the thing that strikes me about your story is the speed with which you fell. And having had everything that society says is the good things to have, to end up with nothing. Can you just lead us through some of those things that happened?
Yeah, I'm gambling a little bit recreationally, and then I stepped over the line. I've spent more money than I should. And that makes me even crosser. That makes me put bigger stakes on. I'm withdrawing into myself. I'm not being a great husband. When Emma says, Justin, we've been invited out to a dinner party this weekend. Do you want to come? I'd say, oh, no, you go. I'll look after Matthew, because Matthew by then needs full-time care. But actually what I'm really saying to her is, you go, because it gives me an opportunity to stay at home and gamble. And at first, this is just a little habit, something that's fine, but it's secret. And then it does get out of hand, because I start to spend more than I should. I use up a savings, I've remortgaged the house, and all the time you're putting bigger and bigger stakes on to get the same kind of buzz. And when you own your own house and you've got a six-figure salary, you can borrow an awful lot of money. And I borrowed myself up to the end. I had every kind of debt you could imagine. Credit cards, I had loans, I hate to say this, and I still, it chokes me up. I had maybe about 10 payday loans. This is someone who still owns a six-figure salary, a shareholder in a financial services company, the divisional director of a financial services division in the city. And I'm taking out payday loans because I think if I get £500 in my account in the next 2 minutes, that's okay. I can turn that into £1,000 and then I can pay back the £500 that I owe. And look, I've got more money to play with. But by then, and this is a really, really important point to make, I think, by then it had stopped being money. Gambling was a habit that gave me an escape from a reality that I had created, which was a horrible reality. You know, I'd taken money out of the house. It wasn't even only mine. It belonged to my wife. We moved house. We rented a house while we found somewhere else. All the time, Emma can see my mood swings. I'm going from being up here when I'm winning to right down in the very depths of despair. And she's thinking, well, it must be me. Or maybe he's not happy in his job. Or maybe we need to move out to the country. We're living in a small town. So we did. We moved out to the country. And I took the equity that we had in that house. And I used it. I didn't tell her.
I can hear people at home saying, Justin, how could you be so crazy? Mm-hmm. I mean, you're in financial industry for all sorts of things. Yeah. You know what you're talking about. You know figures. And we look at what the payday lenders lend and the rates that they charge. How could you possibly do it?
I think the only way you can answer that is by saying I wasn't in control of what I was doing. Now, I take 100% responsibility for what I did, and I had a choice when I placed that first bet, the second, the third, the hundredth. But after a while, you begin to lose control. This thing takes control of you. You begin to kind of have this hunger to bet, and you all the time you delude yourself that you're going to win, and you're going to pay everything back, and no one need know. And it's a total delusion, complete delusion, because everything a compulsive gambler wins, he puts back in, and the odds are stacked in favour of the table. So that means that ultimately you're going to lose. I knew all of that. And you know, one day Emma opens up the fridge and there's no food in the fridge, and I've spent all my money. I've juggled everything to pay off all the debt, or to pay that portion of the debt that month, because as a director I know that they're checking my credit the whole time, and I didn't have any money left to buy food for my family. Someone with a six-figure salary still. I couldn't say to Emma, we haven't got any money, because then I would have had to tell her the whole story, and I wish I had. And my stupid pride was what stopped me. But I looked in my wallet, there was no money there. All I had was my corporate card for work. So we went to the shop, we bought the groceries, and I paid for it on my corporate card. And then, it wasn't terribly long before I put my first bet on, using my corporate card. Now I knew that when I pressed that button to put a gambling transaction on my corporate card, that my company would see that transaction. Mm. I had built up a reputation in the city, which meant that, you know, I didn't have a problem with working at all. But I put that bet on using my corporate card, and I knew that my career was over. But I still did it. And that's the insanity. And you know, if you want me to, I can give you other examples of insanity, insane behaviour, that no normal person would do. And this is really crucial, because I want people to know that when you're in an addiction, you don't have control. It controls you. And that's not saying that you don't have responsibility for your actions. What I'm saying is that it is insane. It is an illness. There was one occasion when Matthew, bless him, not only now is he epileptic and autistic, but right-side hemiplegic and epileptic. He's also got a diagnosis, mm-hmm, for autism. Autism is the thing that really manifests itself most. He's the little boy on the right. And Matthew, one day, he just wanted to go to swings with his dad. And he didn't see me that much because I used to withdraw at bath time. I used to just go and pretend I was working. And he wanted to go to the swings with his dad. So we went down to my parents-in-law house for lunch. It was raining outside. And Matthew kept saying, "Daddy, Daddy, please take me to the swings." So Emma said, "Okay, go, take him." And we drove back to our house, and I went to get his coat. I put my hand on the coat. The car was outside on the drive with the engine running. And I remembered that that morning I placed a bet, and I thought, I'll just go and check to make sure that I've won and my account's been credited. I went upstairs, and I'd lost that bet, and it made me angry. And 2.5 hours later, I'd emptied my bank account again. And I went downstairs, and Matthew, bless him, had fallen asleep with the tears dried on his face. He cried himself to sleep, and I couldn't even spend an hour with my son. And that is the insanity of an addiction. It drives you forward, and you do things that you just don't want to do. And that's when it really is a problem. When it controls you, and you lose control of it, that's when you need to seek help. But still, I didn't seek help. Still, I had further to fall.
Mm. The word control is key, isn't it? It controlled you by that stage.
Yeah.
And it had come so rapidly. I think that's the staggering thing, that your fall from grace was so quick. I think the other thing about your story was the secretiveness and the lies that you told.
Yes.
I mean, we talked about your Christian heritage and you've talked quite openly about your commitment to the Lord. Mm. And yet when you got gripped by the gambling addiction... lies, secretiveness, spending other people's money, just all flowed with it.
Yes, absolutely. My whole life was a lie. I'd forgotten how to tell the truth. It was easier to tell a lie than it was, even when I didn't need to lie. And my poor wife was the one who bore the brunt of that. And I think with any form of addiction, it's the people around you that get hurt so much. Because they see what's happening, but they question themselves. And particularly gambling addicts, I think, but maybe all addicts, we're very, very good at manipulating and hiding things and covering tracks. And the problem with online gambling is that it's very, very easy to hide your tracks. Everyone goes on the computer. And for me, by then, I was working from home. I'd volunteered to work from home. I used to do my job maybe an hour in the morning. And then I'd have the rest of the day when I'd just be following horse race after horse. I didn't even like horse racing. Horse racing. And when there wasn't a sports event on, and this is the real danger, you've got all these online casinos available to you. And when you start getting into roulette or blackjack or something like that, where you can lose thousands in 15 seconds... that's the speed of it. It gets you, and you can go from really doing fine, all right, thank you very much, to right down there. And the problem with me is I had this pride, and I said to myself, I'm the one that needs to sort this out, because I'm the one that's caused it, which was so wrong. If I put my hand up and said to Emma, I'm really sorry, I've let something get the better of me, can you help me sort this out? I'm sure she would have done.
It's a £7 billion business. And as you said before, it's the betting shops and the casinos and the like which make the money.
Yeah.
And that's where the majority of the $7 billion goes to. You're here tonight because you have overcome the addiction. But before you got to that point of overcoming, you had to go even lower.
Yeah, I did. My work finally saw the transactions that I put on my corporate card. The call came in from my boss. I remember it well. And he said, "Justin, it's terrible. Someone's cloned your credit card. We've got all these gambling transactions on there. We need to get you another one, but we'll have to cancel that. Is that okay?" And I said, "Actually, they're not fraudulent transactions. They're my own transactions." So I went to see HR, and we very quickly realised I couldn't continue to work in financial services. £27,000 worth of gambling transactions over a 2-month period. But you know, you'd think that would be it. I would have, okay, wake up call, got no job, need to sort this out. But I was driving home, it was summer, it was June, and I was placing bets on Wimbledon as we were driving home. But with no job, I then started to sell things in the house. To fund my habit and to pay for us to carry on living. Things that I could easily get rid of without Emma knowing went first. Little bits of silver, pictures, wedding presents. And then one day I finally, I, maybe it was a low point, I realised I had to get money to bet. It's the only way I could get through the day. I was otherwise I'd have been depressed the whole time. So I finally got the courage to take that sword of honour that the Queen had given me for graduating top of my intake. And I took it to the antique shop, and it took me 3 attempts.
You've got it down there, haven't you? Do you want to just pick it up?
Okay. Yes. I took this. And, you know, this is priceless. It's completely priceless. It's not particularly valuable in itself, but to me it is priceless because it represents everything that was good.
There was 400, if I know right, of you at Sandhurst, and you were given that because you were the top one out of the 400.
Yeah, and the Queen, or the Queen's representative, if she's not available on the Sovereign's Parade, presents it to the student that graduates top. And your career is made pretty much in the army. But I was going to hand it on down through the family. And I took it to the shop. I got to the door the first time and I couldn't go through with it. And I took it again. This time I opened the door and I went in, and then I couldn't go through with it. The third time I took it into the shop and I got £200 for it. And as I walked out of the shop, I had tears in my eyes because I knew that I had reached absolute rock bottom, that I would sell the thing that was most precious to me. And the next morning I woke up and I phoned up the shop and I said, "Have you still got it?" And they said, "No, we just sold it. We don't know who we've sold it to. Gone." I tried to self-exclude myself. Emma found out about it. Sadly, she found out because she found a bank statement. If she hadn't found the bank statement, if I'd been able to talk to her, there maybe would have been an element of trust left. But all trust was gone because she found out. And I can remember she was in a tight ball and she looked at me and she said, "Justin, really, is this true? It's gambling transaction after gambling transaction on my bank statement." And I told her, yes, it was. She tried to stand by me. We self-excluded. I talked about 2,500 of those websites being online.
Yes, yeah.
If you want to exclude yourself from gambling, you'd have to go into all of those sites and self-exclude yourself. I had one gambling site that I used to use, and I closed it down. And I got help. I had a couple of sessions. Actually with an alcohol counsellor, not really someone who understood gambling so much. So maybe they didn't quite work, because after 2 weeks I got an email from another online company saying, "Have a £50 free bet." I thought, free bet, that's okay, isn't it? It's not really my money. So I opened up my account, and then I was right back where I was before. This time Emma knew the symptoms. So when she realised that I was betting again, one morning I woke up, and there was no noise of children's television. And there was no sound of laughter and breakfast going on. There was no smell of coffee. The house was quiet. And Emma had gone. She'd taken the boys with her. And, you know, she was right to go because I was self-destructing.
Hmm.
And
so here you were, Justin. You'd lost your job. You'd lost your wife. You'd lost your children. Your car. That was sold quite a while ago. You had to move out of your house because that was taken back, even the rented one that you were in. You got to rock bottom.
That was my rock bottom. And the day I was about to be evicted, I had 5 months rent owing. I was living off a sack of mouldy potatoes. I began to have thoughts, would it be like for my children if I wasn't around anymore? And then Mum turned up. She drove up at, outside the house, and I thought, oh no, do I answer this? Because we'd never really discussed it. You know, I'd hidden it from her. And she came in with my brother and my dad, and they sat down and they said, look, you're going to be thrown out of this house tomorrow. You can either be homeless or you can come back home. Back to the spare room that I left as an 18-year-old, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, about to go out to the world and make a fortune. It wasn't a difficult choice.
So we come to that question then. How, for you, did you overcome gambling and addiction?
Well, that night, when I got back down to Kent, I got down on my knees and I prayed just a really simple prayer. It wasn't incredibly eloquent, and when I prayed it, there weren't any sort of trumpets or angels flying around the room. I just said, Lord, forgive me for what I've done. I'm really truly sorry. If you can, please just come and fix me. And that's the last time. That was November 2012. That's the last time I've ever placed a bet.
Wow. Thank you for emails and texts that are coming in. Stella, you've written and you said, thank you, Justin, for sharing your story. I agree gambling is an illness. I'd go as far as saying that it is a more dangerous addiction than drugs, because the person appears well and sane, yet they are so ill and out of control. We have a member of our family who is addicted to betting on horses. At least that's the bit we know. He, of course, does not admit he's a problem and gets aggressive when it's mentioned. My question is, how do we get the gambler to admit the problem? I pray, but he has no faith of his own. What do we do?
That is such a good question, and it's a question I get lots and lots and lots. You see, it is very difficult. And if you confront someone and they're not in a position ready to find recovery, they'll be aggressive. They'll deny the fact that they're in trouble. They'll pretend they're in control because they're not ready yet to let go. It's the hardest advice, the hardest thing to do is to stand by and watch someone you really, really love self-destructing, particularly when it's affecting you and your children. But sadly, until that person has reached a point where they are ready to find recovery, no matter what you do as a person, it will not help them. You have to kind of give them space. And when I went back that night, back in my mum's house, she gave me space. But there are a couple of things you can do. Try to talk about it often and openly, not in a judgmental, derogatory, put people down way, because that's not going to work, but in an open way, a kind of way that will encourage that person to share with you how much time they're spending, how much money they're spending. It may actually be a release for them. If they feel they're not going to be judged, maybe it will be what gets them to actually realize that they have a problem. And the other thing I'd say is, you can put some blocks in place. You kind of need the person's support to do this, but there's a fantastic bit of software that's free. You can Google it. It's called K9. And if you download K9, it just protects your browser, actually, from any adult content. And it's just, it won't stop that person from betting if they really want to. But you as a person are saying, listen, that behavior is not acceptable in this household. Let's put a block on it here. If you want to bet, you'll have to do it somewhere else.
Okay, so when you say that app is, it, or whatever it is, K9, is it the letter K followed
yes,
by a 9?
Absolutely right. It's just that, capital K, number 9.
And that blocks gambling?
Yes, it does.
What about pornography?
Yes, it does. Adult content.
Okay.
You've got different settings on. Personally, as a Christian man, it's fantastic for me to have that. And I have that on all my... I have it on my PC, I have it on my laptop, I have it on my smartphone. You can also get a family control block on your browser, on your hub, on your home hub. If it's Sky or whatever, you can have a block on, or a family control mechanism that means you've got control over adult content.
Okay. Now, if people want to get in touch with you, because as your journey has gone on, and we haven't got time to talk about everything tonight, but as your journey has gone on, you are now involved in speaking, particularly to men. I mean, tomorrow you told me you're going off to Harlequins, to the rugby, and in fact you're speaking to all the rugby premier teams about the problem of gambling, aren't you?
Yes. I mean, in sportsmen, gambling is a real problem because they've got time and they've got money. And those are two really bad ingredients. If you've got those two things, watch out. I went public when I'd reached recovery on the 17th of August 2013. 5.5 million people woke up and read a two-page spread in the Daily Mail where we talked about an army officer, an army major, losing £750,000 over 3 years. And that was a real wake-up call. But, you know, for me... And when I read it, I thought, oh no, what have I done? The whole world knows I'm an idiot now. It was incredibly liberating because I think one of my issues was that I always pretended to be the person that people wanted me to be. I was the best officer cadet. I had to be the city high flyer. I had to be the perfect husband, the perfect father. And actually, I knew I wasn't those things. So when I went live and I told my story in the Daily Mail, it meant that I suddenly could be free of this sort of burden of having to be brilliant. I really wasn't brilliant. And sharing that story meant that I kind of exposed myself and said, this is the real me. This is Justin.
Okay. Kev's written and he said, I became a drunken drug addict as well as a gambler. I believed I was in control. Truth was nothing. was not going to stop me till I was at the end of myself. I lost everything, my family, home, jobs, friends, health, was 100,000 in debt, ended up on the street. Suicide was my only way out. God called on God and my life changed. Mm. I believe I was going to end up where I did. Many people warned me. I believe that people like me are always going to not stop till it gets so bad that stopping is the only thing left. Thanks, Kev. I think what Kev is saying is you've got to get to the end of yourself.
Yes, you have.
And that's the only way we're going to get up.
Yeah, and that's so brilliantly captured there by Kev. For some people, that rock bottom might not be dramatic. It may be just a bit of a wake-up call. Oh, hang on a minute, I've just had a look at the back. I can't pay a bill here. That may be enough for some people. That might be their rock bottom. For others, we talk about Carluccio, who's got the restaurant chain. He's a terrible gambler. He very nearly took his own life, and he lost his restaurant chain, and it went that far. And sadly, last year in October, I lost a friend. He took his own life because of gambling and because of the debt that it caused, because that's another real problem with this. It's often the debt that causes the relationship breakdown and the issues. And he left a beautiful wife and a young child who now doesn't have a father because of it.
Mm. I mean, suicide, sadly, is one statistic I saw was 1 in 5 of serious gamblers do attempt suicide.
Yeah, there was a question in the survey in 2010 about how happy do you rate yourself from 1 to 10, and the pathological gambler, that 2%, the 500,000 that we talked about, had the same happiness rating as someone with terminal cancer, and that's tragic. But gambling is such a poorly understood addiction. It really isn't well understood at all. If you go to the doctors now, you're just as easy for him to say, oh, here's some pills to help you sleep, and by the way, stop gambling, as you would for him to be able to sort of prescribe a program of treatment. And there's very little treatment available. There really is. Very little.
Okay. No name on this one. It just says, it's not an excuse. You are influenced by an evil spirit with a pride, lies, and compulsive gambling. Mm. And this one from Jill says, I live in a racing town. Gambling has caused many to kill themselves. My son, Chris, is a compulsive gambler, lost everything. I help him to keep him off the streets. I pray all the time for him. Has got sleep apnea too, has got a heart of gold. It's sad.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the love that mother has. You know, and this is what my mum did. You know, she had this huge love for me, but she could see me self-destructing.
Yeah.
And, it's difficult. You want to do something, but very often not doing something is the appropriate thing to do. People often ask me, should I lend them money? Should I give them money? And a lot of people are worried about debts that they might have with gambling companies. The truth is, you're very unlikely to be in debt with a gambling company. The debts that you carry will be debts because you haven't paid your bills because you spent your money on gambling. So when a gambler turns around to people that they love and say, please help me, I need to pay my mortgage, I need to pay my rent, I've got to pay this bill, you want to give them that money, but actually it may be kinder for them to not lend them any money if you know that they have a problem with gambling, because then it will bring the problem.
It's like a drunkard, really, and saying to a drunkard, "We'll just have a little drink," you know, as you ease yourself off. It's just not possible.
No, one thing's for sure: I will never ever be able to go back to gambling. I will, you know, I do believe God fixed me when I asked Him to that time, and I do believe He can fix people. He can break those chains on any addiction, and for some people, He does that very slowly over a long period of time. For me, it was quite dramatic, but I will never take it for granted, and I have to be very, very careful. I need these blocks in place, and I won't even be able to go out and buy a raffle ticket. I just won't be able to.
Okay. This text says, Justin's a great inspiration. I've felt that awful feeling. It's hellish. I'm a gambler myself. I'm fighting my addiction daily. Be strong. Would you say anything to that person?
Yeah. Well, do you know what he said there, or she said there, which is brilliant? Fighting the addiction daily. And the way to do it is to take it one day at a time. Not to think, okay, I'm going to give up alcohol and I'm never going to have another drink. All you have to do is just have not one more drink. It's just one more drink that you have to stop doing. It's the next one. And if you don't have that one bet, you don't have that one drink, you've done well. And then when that day's over, you start again the next day. And you keep taking it in small chunks, bit by bit.
Okay. Mary Jane says, I pray this gentleman will never gamble again. I believe that gambling is a demon, that people need deliverance. I do not believe that gambling is an illness. I pray that gamblers will seek God, who can deliver anyone from an evil spirit. We haven't really talked about how you, from being rock bottom, managed to set you free. Just briefly, as our time is going on, share your story of how that happened.
Well, the next day after I'd said that prayer, the first thing I did is I got sorted with a debt management company. Wonderful charity from my church, a church that I began to go to, and that's fundamental too. I put God right back in the middle of my life again, and I had a regular time with him. Every morning I'd wake up and read his word and talk to him. I'd put God back in the center of my heart, because I truly believe. And you know, if people don't remember anything else about this interview tonight, it's one thing if they can take this, is that addiction or addictive behavior is a symptom of something that's going on inside us. An inner pain, a hurt, maybe even something from childhood, a flaw in our character, something that's inside us that's causing us to medicate. And I hate to quote Russell Brand, because I know he's not the world's greatest Christian, but he was right when he said, drugs and alcohol aren't my problem, life is my problem. Drugs and alcohol are my solution. And if we recognize that actually we need to get healing from within first, let Christ come in, sort that pain out, have him back in our lives, and he's the only one that can do that. Any other form of recovery just deals with the outward symptom. Having Christ at the center of my recovery meant that he could fix me on the inside and make me a whole person again, make me into the person that he wanted me to be. I know I'm a work in progress, but having Christ in the center of my life means that I now have taken control again of those things that were controlling me.
Okay, we're all a work in progress, Justin, so you're no different. Now, you've got that sword there. We had your story earlier on where you said you went to a pawn shop or whatever it was, and it went off and disappeared. So how come you got it now?
Well, after I did that story, the mail story, there are a number of other media things that happened, some TV interviews and some radio interviews and some other newspapers. And a collector saw this Sword of Honour, and he saw it have my name on. He didn't know who I was, but he... He saw my name and he Googled it, and of course when you Google my name it comes up with all the stuff that's happened on the media, and he got in touch with one of the newspapers. The newspaper got in touch with me day before Christmas Eve, just passed, and the newspaper said, Justin, we think we've got some information on your sword. And I was just absolutely amazed, because people, whenever I tell my story, people always say, did you get your sword back?
Yeah.
And I've had to say no, and I'd given up hope. I thought it had gone to America, a collector out there would have taken it, but no, there it was online. A couple of guys from my church helped me, and we bought it, and back at home. And today is one of the only days when it's left my house, so I'm holding on tightly to this now, and I'm not going to let it go again.
Well, that's the goodness of God that he allowed you to have that back.
Yeah.
Justin hasn't asked me to do this, so let me do it. This is a book which talks about Justin's story. It's entitled Tales I Lose. If you know somebody who's involved in addiction of any kind, not just gambling, then I'd recommend this book to you. And can I say, it's very much a book that is written, it's a man's man telling the story, and I'd certainly recommend it as one. In fact, you were telling me before the program that in Amazon, it was the number one in the gambling section, was it?
Yes.
Yeah.
In fact, even last week, just a couple of weeks ago on Amazon, it was the number one bestseller for the gambling addiction genre.
Okay. Yeah. So recommend that to you. The Compulsive Gambler Who Lost His Shirt for Good. But I was very interested, but when I got the book, there was a little card inside it which talked about the recovery course. And what Justin is doing is seeking to help others through the experiences that he's had. And you've now begun to develop a recovery course. And not only that, but you're also involved in going out all over the country and speaking and sharing your story. And From time to time on the TV screen, we've been putting Justin's website. It's still a work in progress, but if people contact you there, yes, then you'll respond to them. That's
absolutely
right, isn't it?
Yes, and indeed. And in the back page of my book is my email address, and I really do encourage people to get in touch if they've got concerns or worries or they want any advice at all. Gambling is one of those things that people don't like to talk about. Being a drug addict or an alcoholic is now almost de rigueur, but to be a gambler, it's the lowest of the low. And I put my hand up, and I'm happy to share my experience with anyone.
Okay, so what is the recovery course?
The recovery course is a Christ-based recovery course. It follows the 12 steps, just like all the anonymous fellowships do. So if you turn up to a meeting at AA or Narcotics Anonymous or Gamblers Anonymous, you'll follow the 12 steps. But the problem with that is that when they were first designed, those 12 steps were wonderful spiritual steps designed by two Christian men from San Francisco in the 1930s. Now, the anonymous fellowships have been secularized, and we can't talk about God anymore. We have to talk about a God of our own understanding or our higher power. But I just wanted to put my hand up when I was going along to the AA meetings and say, actually, let's be honest, it's God. So the recovery course is a course which puts God back at the center of it. It's an acknowledgement of the fact that we need to change from the inside when we've got these problems. And we need prayer and we need help. And it is absolutely a spiritual battle. I do truthfully believe that. But it follows the 12 steps. It's on the alpha format, so we have a meal, we have a talk centrally, and then we do group work. And it's the group work that really people find their recovery. And we get them to do some work during the week, and then they come back. It's over 12 weeks. Just coming to the end of our third course, and we've seen some wonderful things. We've seen people become Christians for the first time, people having relationships with God restored, people breaking those chains and getting free of their addictions. It is a tremendous course. The main course, or the biggest course, I guess, is run at Holy Trinity Brompton. I think the next one starts later in the year. I would encourage anyone, if you were to Google the recovery course, I think you'd find HTB's recovery course there, and find out whether there's one run locally at a church near you.
Okay, we've only got a few minutes left in the programme. If somebody's watching tonight who is struggling with addiction, and as we said, it mightn't be gambling, it might be pornography, it might be some other form of addiction that they have, you clearly are a testimony that there is hope, that there is recovery, but how would you encourage them tonight?
Number one, most fundamental issue is to be honest about it. The danger when you hide it away is that you can justify it, and it is bad if you're hiding things away, pulling down the shutters, not letting anyone in, it's going to run out of control. Please, 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 open up, be honest, talk to someone. People might be shocked when they first hear it, but I tell you what, they'll help you, they'll understand. It's very difficult for us as Christians to talk about things, our habits and addictions that we hide. Please be honest and open, because there is great recovery there, but you will never find recovery unless you're honest and open.
All right, and also it's getting to that point of realizing that of yourself, you can do nothing.
So true. So true. Absolutely. We talk about the 12-step recovery. The second step is all about handing over the car keys, if you like, to let God take control, realizing that you can't control this on your own and that you need God to come in and take control of it.
Okay. David, you've written and you've said, I too have been afflicted by gambling and was on the verge of losing everything before I finally hit rock bottom. That's what you've just said, isn't it? Number two on your recovery course. Not until I admitted that I couldn't help myself was I in a position to help myself. The best thing that my wife did was pray for me continually, as nothing she said got through to me.
So
again, that fits in. You said
so
your mum didn't criticise,
nope,
just loved.
Yeah.
And David, you write and say, I was in a dark place and didn't realise it. Even when I did, I was too ashamed, proud and guilt-ridden to admit it to myself or others. Recovery started with asking Jesus for forgiveness and seeking help from special Christian friends. That's a great story. Well, we're coming to the last minute of it. Supposing somebody says, I think there's somebody in my family who's got addiction. Yeah. Are there some telltale signs
yes.
which help us to understand?
Absolutely. If you're talking about gambling, and which is one of the hardest ones to spot, you'll find that people are spending a bit too long on the computer. And do you know what? There's even this thing called FAD, Facebook Addiction Disorder, which is a recognised medical addiction now. 280 million people afflicted worldwide. But I'm not talking about social media. If people are spending and being secretive about what they're doing on the internet, if there are financial issues, bills that normally would be paid, maybe things are returned unpaid, if you maybe ask your husband or your wife, how are the finances? Can we talk about them? They might be a bit evasive about that. They certainly wouldn't want to share a bank statement with you. So if you're open about your financial situation as a husband and a wife anyway in the family, I think it's incredibly healthy. But if you aren't open, if someone has control over it and you're worried about them, ask okay. to share.
All right. Well, Justin, it's been a pleasure to talk to you. I've been talking to Justin Rees-Larkin. We've been talking about gambling and addiction that I believe is affects so many within the church. But there is hope and God can do things. God bless you. Thanks. Bye-bye.
The program you've been watching was made possible because of your support for the Revelation Foundation. Programs take time, effort and money. If you'd like to make similar programs possible, then please send your gift to the Revelation Foundation. The details are on the screen.
I shall see you soon again in the land of life. I shall hear your voice again, singing praise to the Lamb. No more heartache, no more pain. You are home free. So I'll see you soon again in the land.
Hope. Amen. Right now, millions of children are in grave danger. All over the world, children as young as 2 or 3 struggle to survive on the streets. Hungry, sick from disease, and at constant risk of exploitation. It's filthy and it's dangerous, but this is their home. Just £3 could provide a child with safe shelter for 3 days. Please text PROTECT to 70111. UNICEF will use your gift to get hot meals to hungry children, to help them learn to read and write, to help make them safe. But tonight, millions of children around the world will sleep on streets like this one. Every minute they're here, they're in danger. Can you imagine your child in a place like this? I can't. Please don't wait. Text PROTECT to 70111 and give £3 to help make a child safe tonight. Thank you.
Revelation Television is committed to making a wide range of Christian television programs. From studies to documentaries, from debates to music programs, from testimonies to talk shows.